Have you seen any of my previous videos in detail? Especially the B-roll shots? Take for example this shot. The shot is completely shaky and you can easily tell that the shot is made without any camera stabilizers. Interesting problem calls for interesting solution. So this week, let's put together a camera slider for shooting smooth shots. If you search online, you can find numerous tutorials for building a camera slider. However, most of the tutorials make use of copper or PVC pipes to keep the cost low. But the problem is the deforming of the pipes over a period of time and resulting in bad shots again. I plan to build a sturdy and long-lasting slider, so here are the parts for making one. Let's take a look at each of these parts. I'm building a pretty big one, so I have chosen rods with 8mm dia and 500mm length. I'm going to build a 2-axis slider first to gain some experience and then build a 3-axis one eventually. This is the 3D design for the slider. Here you can see the base plate for the camera attached to the rods using linear bearings for it to move freely over the rods. The blue colored end is the base plate for fixing the stepper motor, and similarly, the orange colored one is for fixing the electronics. Now, when the motor moves from one end to the other, it has to stop once it reaches the end, else it may damage some parts of the slider. For stopping the slider once it reaches the end, I'm going to use an end stop module at both ends. There is a switch in the end stop module. Now, when the slider reaches the end, it closes the switch to send a trigger to the microcontroller. Then the microcontroller sends a signal to stop the motor and rotate in the opposite direction to release the switch. I will let you know about these holes in a bit. Okay, to start with, I'm going to 3D print all the necessary parts. First, the electronic base plate. Then the box for holding the electronics. Base plate for the camera. Then the base plate for the motor. End stop modules. And finally, a couple of conduit holders that I will be using to fix the wire concealing conduits. Okay, we can now attach the linear bearings to the base plate. Next, we have to connect the rail support for the linear rods to the ends of the shaft. Let's start with the side of the motor. Then similarly fix it at the electronics end. Now we are good to fix the linear rods. We have to be cautious while we fix the rod to the bearings, since any misalignment can damage the bearings. The movement is pretty smooth. I'm going to use a 1/4-inch tripod adapter screw on the base plate for mounting it on a tripod. Okay, now let's start fixing the stepper motor to the base plate.
We will be using a timing belt to connect the camera base plate to the stepper motor.
So first, we have to prepare an idler pulley module. I have an idler pulley with 5mm bore for a 6mm belt. Unfortunately, I don't have screws for this pulley, so I'm going to do a workaround. I got a 3mm 3D printed adapter for attaching the pulley to the structure. Let's fix it to the electronic base plate side of the slider. Good, it fits perfect. Now I'm going to attach a 6mm timing belt to the camera base plate. I'm going to loop it through the hole in the cam plate and then zip tie it to close it. I have 2 meters of the timing belt, so I think that should be more than sufficient for the slider. I'm going to use a GT2 aluminum pulley on the motor side for attaching the timing belt to it. Now again, loop it through the GT2 pulley and fix it to the camera base plate. Okay, it looks like the belt is not taut enough. This will cause major problems when the base plate moves with the camera on it. So I'm going to tighten it now. I'm going to use a timing belt tensioner spring to make it stiff. Okay, time to fix the end-stop modules. I have tried to keep everything plug and play so that I can always replace any part if it does not work or fails after a few runs. We can always shift to a single 3D printed block once we have a robust design. Okay, this looks good. I have provided some holes in the electronics casing for heat dissipation. I am using a 11.1 volt lithium ion battery for powering the circuit. This battery has a 2200 milliampere hour capacity. The charging circuit is included within the battery, so I don't have to worry about that. I just have to plug in a 12 volt DC power supply and I'm good to go. Before we start assembling the whole thing, we have to start with fixing the battery DC jack to the side of the casing. Let's place this case on the electronics base plate. It looks like it is shaping up well. On the electronics end, I plan to use an ESP32 microcontroller development board, a stepper motor driver module, a small display for updates and control menu. For better visibility in the sunlight, I'm going to use an OLED display. And finally, a rotary encoder module for better precision and position control. You can use the link displayed above to know more about the details of designing the circuit. I have got the assembled circuit ready. Let me start with connecting the stepper motor cables. Then prepare the end stop module cables by passing it through a sleeve to connect it to the circuit. Now I have to get the wires from the motor end to the electronic circuit end. For a professional look, I'm going to use steel rods to get the cables from one side to the other. I have got 3D printed brackets to support the rod at both ends. I'm going to use a couple of sleeves to further conceal the wires that are popping out. The sleeves are actually heat shrink tubes, so let's show them in flame. Next, I have got the headers fixed to the end of the wires. Since the battery and electronics are in the same compartment, I'm going to use a simple plastic sheet to separate both. Now I'm going to add a few things to the electronics box faceplate. I'm going to start with the encoder, then an SPST switch to power on and off the device, and finally the display. Now that we have got all the electronics packed into this compartment, we can close the compartment with the lid. Time for a system check. Looks good. Now let's try an outdoor shot with this slider. Uh-oh, looks like the slider is struggling to move for some reason. My handheld shot was much better than this. So after checking the device, I found the camera base plate was not aligned to the motor pulley, causing a slight aberration in the movement. This seems to be the reason for the shaky and bad video. Anyway, I did some further research to iron out any more problems concerning vibrations and found that using 4 linear bearings will substantially improve the movement of the base. So I'm going to modify this to a 4 bearing system. Also, the vibrations from the motor seem to be affecting all parts of the support system. And the base plate also appears to be slightly deforming. A CNC based base plate will be the right solution for the problem, but I unfortunately don't have access to it. So I'm going to increase the density of the base plate by increasing the infill density value to 80% and reprint all those parts. Okay, the modified 4 bearing slider system is ready. Let's fire it up. Upon starting, the Tink logo will be displayed followed by the menu options. I plan to use the slider in three modes. First, the real-time mode. First of all, the cam plate will automatically reset to its home position, which is the electronic side of the slider. Okay, it is sliding slowly into position. In this mode, I can use the encoder to change the position of the cam plate in real time. Say for example, I want it further to the left, then I rotate the encoder to the left or vice versa. Also, the encoder doubles as speed control, meaning the cam plate will move at the rate at which I rotate the encoder. Let me show you a sample video that I shot in this mode. You can notice that the stability of the video has significantly improved. Next, we have the time-lapse mode. This can further be used in two different modes: manual and automated time-lapse modes. Let's try the manual mode first. This is similar to the real-time mode, but with one difference. You can bring down the sliding time as low as 0.1 mm per second. I shot a sunrise in this mode. Let's check that out. Not bad. Now, the manual mode allows you to set a time period and have the cam plate move through the set period. You can set the time period in hours, minutes, or even seconds. Let me configure the sliding time to 1 minute. So the cam plate would move from one end to the other in 60 seconds. The third mode is a fixed timing mode, which basically is a preset for different scenarios. Say for example, shooting a flower, people, product review, or quick. For example, the review mode helps you to shoot a B-roll in an already preset manner. So the cam plate would accelerate, then reach a stable speed, and finally decelerate before reaching the end of the slider. Check out this video of the UFI device that I shot using this mode. Now the flower mode. People mode. This slider can be used even with a mobile phone with a tripod adapter.
Okay, our slider is ready. I will be updating the code and other technical details on my Instructables page. So don't forget to check it out. If you like to construct one by yourself, I am leaving the links to the design files below. I will explain the electronics design in my next video. Thanks for watching this one. Bye.